Now we want to talk about the main property of operators, unbounded operators, which we want to consider, namely the self-adjointness. And in the case of unbounded operators, we have to distinguish between symmetric and self-adjoint. So this chapter will be about symmetric and self-adjoint operators. Of course, our operators will typically be unbounded, because for bounded operators, we already know what self-adjoint operators are, and there's no difference between symmetric and self-adjoint. But in the unbounded case, so there are different possibilities to say what self-adjoint should mean, and what should be the analog of self-adjointness in the unbounded case. And maybe the most naive definition or property which you write down is that you just write down what it means to be self-adjoint, that you can bring your operator from one side in the inner product to the other. And then, of course, in the case of unbounded operators, you cannot apply your operator to any element in the Hilbert space, so you just require that this is true for all vectors in the Hilbert space for which this makes sense. Huh? And that's, maybe that's what you would write down canonically, and that is what we are going to call symmetric. So we say T is called symmetric or Hermitian sometimes. So that's the same. So we do not distinguish between self-adjoint and Hermitian. Yeah, if what happens, so if we have this equality, which in a bounded case determines the self-adjointness of an operator, so namely that we can write Txy, this inner product, so this is the same, if we bring the T to the other side, huh? There it would appear as a T star, but in a self-adjoint case, this should be a T, so this should be the same as Xty. And we require this wherever it makes sense. So here we apply T to X, here we apply T to Y, so X and Y both should be in the domain of our operator. So this should be true for all X and Y in the domain. Okay, and if you think what this means in terms of the adjoint, this actually means that T is not necessarily equal to the adjoint, but T is okay, subset of the adjoint, or T star is an extension of T. And the reason is that we have defined our operator T star coming with its own domain. And this here is requiring that the domain of T star is at least the domain of T, and there they agree, but in general it could happen that the domain of T star is bigger than the domain of T. Okay, and of course, if we require an operator to be self-adjoint, we actually should require that T is equal to T star, but this means we should not only have equality on the intersection of the domains, but the domains should also agree. So T star comes with its own domain. The domain of T star is made as big as possible to respect the definition equation, defining equation for T star. Good, okay, so that's symmetric. That's the thing which you would write down, and that's what is usually easy to check. If you have defined operator, if you write down a domain and you define your operator, and then things like this are easy to check, because this just means you check things on a domain which you have, which you are given quite a priori. But what we really mean with self-adjoint, that's the second part of the definition, and this is in general different from symmetric, a stronger condition. So namely, T is called self-adjoint if T star is not just an extension of T, but if they are really equal. Equal in the sense of unbounded operators, which means also their domains are equal. So if T is really equal to T star, and so this means, first of all, that we have what we have above, so T is symmetric, but we also have to have the equality of the domains between T and T star, so the domain of T must be equal to to the domain of T star, not just a subset. And that's usually something which is harder to check, because for this we really have to calculate, get our hands on the domain of T star, which, okay, I mean the domain of T is given by us at the beginning, but the domain of T star is something which depends on the domain of T and which we have to calculate, and this might be not so easy. So this is really a stronger condition, which usually is much harder to check than the symmetry. Yeah, okay, and then maybe in the context of closed and closable, we also saw that there is somehow a kind of trivial extension of operators, where we also might have chosen the domain, our domain in the beginning too small, but we can, if our operator is closable, we can close it, and then the difference between the closure of the operator and the operator itself is usually not so big. So it might be that we have chosen our domain a little bit too small, so that we don't have this equality, but after the closing of our domain, we might get this equality. And then we have an operator which is as good as a self-adjoint operator, and we call this essentially self-adjoint. So, and that's the operators which we usually will have. So T is called essentially self-adjoint if maybe the operator itself is not self-adjoint, but if we take the closure, then it is self-adjoint. Of course, we have to ensure that it is closable, but we only consider closable operators. So if not, maybe not T, but if we take the closure of T, this is self-adjoint. And the general idea is that the difference between T and its closure is not really a big one. So the closure usually has more or less the same properties as the operator itself, or maybe the other way around. So maybe it's just because it might be a bit tedious to really define the domain of our operator exactly, but we write down a domain which is nice to work on and which is so big that it can be closed, but maybe there is often not a need to do it. Good, okay, so that's the operators which we want. So what we really want is self-adjoint. Essentially self-adjoint is more or less the same, so that's good enough. But usually what we see more or less directly is maybe a symmetric operator. And then we have to understand the gap between symmetric and self-adjoint. Okay, but before we do this, maybe a few remarks are in order. So first of all, of course, also here, I talked about the closure of our operators. So this means, of course, we are only interested in closable operators, because otherwise there is no analysis we have at our disposal. And so the question, of course, is why shouldn't I have also required that our symmetric operators are closable? Because otherwise, okay, it's not good operators. But I don't have to require this, because the closability of T follows from the symmetry. So a symmetric operator is always closable. So we don't have to require this. Let me put this down here. Some remarks. So the first is exactly this. So note that a symmetric operator is closable. Yeah, why is this? Okay, since, so why is this? So what we have to see, I mean, we have seen that closability is the same as that we have an adjoint, in the sense that the domain of the adjoint is dense. So what we have to check is that the domain of T star is dense in the Hilbert space. Yeah, but if we have a symmetry condition, then we see that this tells us something about T star, namely it tells us that T star is an extension of T, which in particular means that the domain of T star contains the domain of T. But T as our operator is, by definition, densely defined. So the domain of T star contains the domain of T because of the symmetry condition. And this domain is dense in H. But But then, of course, the bigger domain is also dense in H. Okay, so we see that the symmetry requirement includes closability. Yeah? This means a symmetry is a good analytic condition. Good. Then maybe the second remark about this essentially self-adjoint. There we have seen that, okay, my operator is by definition essentially self-adjoint if I have an extension which is self-adjoint, and namely the closure of T. So the closure of T is somehow the smallest possible extension which we can take. And now I'm claiming this is actually the only self-adjoint extension. So this is exactly the extension which we should take. So T essentially self-adjoint is equivalent to the fact that T has exactly one self-adjoint extension. And this self-adjoint extension is the closure of T. So usually if I have an operator which is maybe only symmetric, I can ask the question, and we will ask this question later and see examples, we can ask the questions, are there extensions which are self-adjoint? And an operator might have different self-adjoint extensions. Okay. But usually those self-adjoint extensions are not comparable to each other. And here we say we have one self-adjoint extension, which is just a closure. Okay. And then the question is, can we have more? But if we then would have more, then this would be a would have to be an extension of the closure, which is self-adjoint. And the point is, a self-adjoint operator cannot be extended anymore to a self-adjoint operator. So if the domain of the operator is so big that it is really self-adjoint, then I cannot extend the domain and keep the self-adjointness. That's what is here in the background. And so maybe let me put this down here a bit more explicitly. So namely, if I assume I have two operators and T is an extension of S and both are self-adjoint, then I'm claiming it's not possible that T is really an extension. It's a proper extension. Then it must be equal to S. So I say if S is self-adjoint and if T is self-adjoint, then I'm claiming that this means that S and T must be the same. Yeah, and this is just writing down what all these properties mean. So what we have to see, so we have S, or T is an extension of S. Then if I take the adjoint of this relation, then I get the same relation for the adjoints, but the other way around. Because I mean, if I have stronger conditions, if I'm making the domain here bigger, this means I have stronger conditions for the domain of T star, which means I'm making the domain of T star smaller. So this means that T star has S star as an extension. Yeah, but T star is by assumption the same as T, because we assume T is self-adjoint, and S star is the same as S, because we assume S is self-adjoint. And then you see I'm getting here that T has S as an extension. So here I started from S, or T is an extension of S, and now I see that S is also an extension of T, which means they must be the same. Their domains must be the same. So from all this here, from this and this, it follows that S is actually equal to T. So this means if I have a self-adjoint operator, I cannot extend it anymore and keep the self-adjointness. And if I have a essentially self-adjoint operator, I can make the extension to the closure, but there I have no freedom, I just go to the closure, that's okay, there's no other possibility of extending it in a different way up to the closure, and then the closure is self-adjoint, but then I cannot extend it further to another self-adjoint operator. Okay. Yeah, so this means self-adjoint means there's no way of extending it further. Essentially, self-adjoint means I can extend it to the closure. Maybe I should do it. Then I get a self-adjoint one, but then that's it. Yeah. And now the main point, of course, is that symmetric and self-adjoint, or also essentially self-adjoint, are not the same. So what we really are interested in are, let's say, the essentially self-adjoint operators. And this, of course, is a subset of the symmetric operators. But it's not, it's really different. Huh? So there are much more symmetric operators than essentially self-adjoint operators. And our point will be to see how we can get from symmetric operators to self-adjoint operators, or essentially self-adjoint operators. Because that's what we really need. All the nice properties, all the good things which we have in this context will only be true, all the nice mathematical theory will only be true for self-adjoint operators, not for symmetric ones. So that's the dilemma. That's easy to check. But there are no nice mathematical theory for these operators. This is much harder to check, but that's really what we need and want, because there we have a lot of very strong statements which we can say about this. Huh? So, okay, so all the good things, and maybe let me say what I really mean with this. So there are essentially two things about which we will talk later, namely the spectral theorem, and also the theorem of Stone. So that's the two cornerstones of the theory of nice operators. They are only true for self-adjoint, or also for essentially self-adjoint operators, but not for just symmetric operators in general. So those things are only true for essentially self-adjoint operators, but not for symmetric operators in general. Yeah, okay, and of course this means what we should now do is really to understand how to decide when a symmetric operator is self-adjoint or essentially self-adjoint.